people know Robin Kelley is professor and chair of history at UCLA, and has explored the history of social movements, African diaspora, Black intellectual life, music, art, culture, through a variety of different articles, essays, and books that include Free Race Rebels, Freedom Dreams, Colonialism, The Life and Times of American Originals, Mayan Theater, Africa Speaks, America Answers. From the point of view of CPE, we couldn't be more excited to have Robin here to help our thinking through this part of this book and this overall study project. Yes, because he is a historian well-versed in the period and the geography in which this book is taking place, but also because I would argue that his work, in a very generous way, invites us to energetically explore history. Its time, its place, its condition, the economics, the social elements of things, but to not stop reading at the kind of more formal political texts or organizations and actions of a given moment, but also to read the daily life that's going on in and around these moments or that makes up those moments, the music, the art, the connections that individuals and groups of people are having, the disconnections, the contradictions, and the possibilities that are born of these moments and carried to life by the actual people who are living and struggling in these times. I am grateful for the insightfulness, the attentiveness, the rigorous, and the humorous and hopeful way that Robin's work helps us create. Rachel's gonna kill me. She's accused me of quoting Gramsci too much. Idea of trying to create this critical inventory, right, of this kind of accumulation of experience that we have through our lives and through the generations, then I feel like he does that with gusto and helps us critically elaborate, helps us to develop a critical elaboration that's really necessary to understand where we've been and therefore where we are and therefore where we could possibly go. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Robin Kelley.
I wrote some notes, and what I want to do with this is spend probably about 30 minutes just going over the big picture to walk us through what these three chapters show us. One of the things that, as you know from the book, it's really detailed, and it's detailed for a reason. Part of it has to do with the fact that it was written quickly. He wrote that book in 2 years, basically. And number one, number two, he's been working on it for 25, 30 years. So he wrote an article in, as you probably know, in the American Historical Review, a long time ago, on the benefits of Reconstruction. And so he had a case to be made. I mean, he was trying to make the case that Reconstruction wasn't what you see in Birth of a Nation. And so he's going to pile on as much material and data and evidence to prove that. And keep in mind, you know, just to be fair to him, he's dealing with a world, unlike, sort of like ours, but it's actually more extreme, where people still, Harvard professors cannot get their mind around the fact that Black people are not inferior. Mm. So he's also trying to demonstrate that, you know, intelligence is something that we actually have. It's not necessarily native either. Because he's pushing back against that notion, and somehow such a thing as a native intelligence, that means it's like sort of the mammy who has like native knowledge that she doesn't have to go to school for. She just knows it's in her bones. Musicians, it's in their bones, that sort of thing. Okay. So now I put this picture up for a reason. It's funny because it speaks precisely to your commentary. This is what Reconstruction looked like. Mm. This is what a political meeting looked like. We have women. We have men, we have kids, all engaged in a conversation, right? Not just what we think of as leadership. And so, in some ways, this is what mass movement looks like. So we're gonna come back to that in a second. Okay, so the chapters you read, I think one of the reasons you probably liked them a lot, I mean, I love those chapters, because this is the main story of radical reconstruction. This is, I mean, even though he walks over some territory you've gone over earlier, he talks about the black codes in Mississippi and South Carolina, and so you know all about the black codes. So he walks through it and shows you at the local level what's happening. But that chapter called The Price of Disaster, that is the pivot. That is the key chapter which explains almost everything. And here he anchors much of his argument on political economy. And so he says the failure of Reconstruction, you know, is obviously due to what DuBois calls the American blind spot. And you got that, it's great. And most people who quote DuBois or refer to him always refer to that. The American blind spot, race. If it wasn't for those white working class people working against their interests, things could have been different. But that's not exactly the DuBois' whole argument. That's not, he's talking about the role of Northern capitalism. This is where I'm gonna go straight to your question. The role that Northern capital played in concert with, and sometimes in opposition to, the planters, right, the old Southern oligarchy, and sometimes in concert with the black proletariat, and definitely against their interests. So on page 327, he talks about the main enemy to abolition democracy was a tremendous new and rising power of organized wealth and capitalist industry in the world. So I wanted to end, what does that look like? Okay, so I'm just gonna put all these up here so I have to keep going back down my list here. Okay, so first of all, this is war. So war destroyed, I mean, virtually destroyed the Southern economy. And destroyed in many ways. I mean, you know, the physical landscape was destroyed, structures were destroyed. Keep in mind, and I know you figured this out, that the Mississippi Valley went from having more millionaires in the United States than any other part of the United States to having very few. And it wasn't the loss of land. It's human capital. And that's what he keeps talking about that. Like the loss of people. New York wasn't where rich people lived. It was the Mississippi Valley. And when emancipation took place, that's why the big debate was how can we compensate these landholders, these slaveholders, for the loss of human capital? That's what made part of the process of abolition so revolutionary. There was no the discussion of compensation ended, as you know. In any case, so the Southern economy was wrecked. The South was burdened with a war debt. So this constant talk about the war debt. Someone had to pay for that war, okay? And the loss of property in the slave people. Meanwhile, the North, where the battle wasn't taking place, had prosperity, right? Their structures were in place. I mean, you had wars in the streets, but it's not the same thing. So what happened in the North? Railroads thrived. Okay, carried troops and supplies. And remember, railways were private. They got public funds, but they were private. So people made a lot of money off of that. They profited from the closing of the Mississippi River. Because once the river was closed, you got railroads who were moving people back. The meatpacking industry boomed based on military demand. Much of the technology around meatpacking has to do with the conditions of the war. Chicago experienced unprecedented growth in population. Construction, banking, manufacturing, they had woolen mills in New England making uniforms. Right? So the North is making so much money. And when I say the North, not everyone in the North. Northern working class, not. Northern capital, meaning the bourgeoisie, is making huge amounts of money. Agriculture flourished. The frontier of cultivation pushed westward. Westward expansion was limited in some ways by the war, but it also was fueled by the war because it had to grow more. And machinery and immigration replaced lost labor. Okay, so the second slide. So during this wartime boom, the Republican Party was the party of capital. It was a party of industrialists, and it was a party of free labor and free soil. And you probably know about the free soil movement. That was just basically Western movement of people who did not want to compete with slaveholders. They were not necessarily abolitionists. They just did not want to compete with slave capital. So today with the Republican Party. No surprise that Congress adopted economic policies that promoted industrial expansion and wealth expansion. Okay? The next one, the federal government encouraged immigration under labor contracts to make up for the loss of men in the war. So you have great immigration, that's low wage labor. There's low wage labor coming. To promote agricultural development, Congress passed the Homestead Act. Now, a lot of you know the Homestead Act, you know, you read a little bit about it in the regular book here. But the Homestead Act in 1862, during the Civil War, keep that in mind, during the Civil War, offered free land to settlers, Indian lands, barring anyone who had been in rebellion. When I say Indian lands, you know it's all Indian lands. Mm-hmm. But right. In this case, we're talking about lands that were by treaty set aside.
Right. Right.
And then the treaty was broken, which of course is a violation of the Constitution. Yeah. Because the Constitution says the one law that can't be challenged is international treaties.
Right.
Treaties. And in any case, so Congress claimed, quote, it was federally owned land, but remember, again, it was seized by from indigenous people.
Right.
Now, what's critically important here, and this is the last part of it, is that Congress gave huge grants of public land and government bonds for internal developments, especially to railroad companies. So Transcontinental Railroad completed in 1869, didn't just get land for the tracks, they got all the land around it. And that changed the dynamics. Mm-hmm. And so my whole point of laying this out is to say that what DuBois calls northern capital was not as strong as it was until after the war. So in other words, there wasn't this sort of fixed thing called northern capital always powerful. It became powerful as a result of those wars. And in fact, northern capital was on par with southern capital, right, before the war. And that's why I keep saying there were more millionaires in the Mississippi Valley, and part of what made the Mississippi Valley so profitable wasn't just the exploitation of human labor through slavery, but the riverboat. The riverboat, the steam engine, the steam riverboat. So think about what it means when we think of the South as a backwater, when in fact the most advanced technology is taking place in the South. See, and again, DuBois is trying to tell us that over and over again. He's saying the future of American democracy is here because the South is so advanced. Not because it's backwards. It becomes backwards through its failure. Okay? In any case, so now, in this period of time, you know, we've got to look at what's at stake. So what I want to do is just quickly go over what different constituencies imagine a post-slavery society would look like. Okay, so take the Southern planters and industrial tradition of it. And they don't share everything. But there's certain things that you share. They want cheap docile labor, okay? Black and white, okay? Black and white, to make a profit. They want to tie that labor, especially black labor, to the South, into the plantation economy. So people don't want to give up the plantation economy structure. Eventually, part of it collapses, and we can talk about that. That's actually later in the book. They want to regain their political dominance as a class, okay? And these are this is really the Southern planters and in some ways the New South industrialists. They viewed the role of the state, right, as to provide infrastructure for the economy, you know, roads, railroads, you know, that sort of thing, tax breaks, police and military apparatus to control or suppress labor, because that's the purpose of this of state violence. It's not so much to limit crime, but to basically force people through criminalization into forced labor, other forms of labor. And remember that during radical reconstruction, the state was viewed as repressive force against the South. Remember that. We're gonna come back to that in a second. Northern industrialist vision. Again, not always unified, but they also wanted cheap labor. But they wanted mobile labor. They didn't want labor tied down in the way that Southern planters did. They wanted free labor to work in northern vacuums and southern mills. They also saw slavery as a problem, as a fetter, as a drain to the system, because they want free labor. For obvious reasons, free labor is not only mobile, but free labor is consumers. They want to sell products. And capital then is also not responsible for its action. It's simple. They wanted to maintain, again, financial dominance, then political dominance. And they also viewed the state role as to support capital. Like the Southern planters in the New South industrialists, they wanted the state to provide infrastructure, tax incentives. Again, the repressive arm of labor against revolts, providing land, you know, think about the millions of acres of public land given to railroads, to companies to squeeze out small farmers. Now, we're not going to talk much about this, but think about what it means to say, I want the state to provide these industrialists land, when the struggle for land on the part of formerly enslaved people as a right, as a reparation, as a foundation for a new economy, that they had to fight so hard to get that, and of course they lost that battle. But the railroads got land. Just remember that. Just, if they just distributed as much land to the railroads, to the, you know, formerly enslaved people, you would have had a dramatic shift in the economy. Now compare this, finally, to free people's vision of a society. This is proposed by former slaves. Okay, we begin with the state. The state's role is to provide economic support for those in need. Not for everyone automatically, but a kind of a welfare state that those at the bottom who need it, you know, would have support. It would be to protect its citizens from violence and exploitation. And that includes the right to civil liberties, like the right to marry. Which we got to realize that the 14th Amendment is also a sort of recognition of the right of people to be, married, right? The right to maintain families and communities, provide education. You know, we talked about that in the beginning. Free universal public education, housing for those who need it, like the blind, the infirm, others, public services for all people. Again, I just want to emphasize this. We know this, but we always have to remember that there was never, never an argument on the part of few people in those conversations saying, we want these things for black people. We want all people. You know, schools weren't, they said, we want black schools. We want schools for all. In fact, you remember reading in the Mississippi State Constitution, they not only wanted schools for all people, but based on an integrated foundation, you know, integrated basis. Okay, so, they felt that the state should work actively to achieve and defend equality for all, and to take land from the people who committed a crime, that is treason. To seize land from the former rebels, the masses, indeed, to redistribute that land to these people as reparations for wages, for unpaid wages. You know, we could talk in our conversation about the land question. I kind of took some of this about. DuBois does talk about it. But it is so foundational to the story. I'm going to say a little bit about why man was redistributed in great numbers. So now, if you don't mind, I'm going to do something a little different. I'm going to say a few things that are not in the DuBois's book that help us understand things that he could possibly have known because of the way the scholarship was set up, but things that are evidence of why we know this was a few people's vision. Okay. So we have to understand the implications of the forces of all public the implications of emancipation and reconstruction for the legal recognition of families. I mentioned the 14th Amendment, black marriages. Also keep in mind that one of the first things that enslaved people did, you know, as we talked, read about this in earlier chapters, was to gather children, children who were about to be apprenticed, and to adopt a mass adoption, the biggest mass adoption in the history of the United States. It's not formal adoption, but a lot of the children, so when you think about the lineage, a lot of the children were just left, they were abandoned, they were in situations where they would have been apprenticed, and Black families just took children so that they could not be enslaved. That is significant. That's really significant to think about, because again, they didn't expect the state to do that. They expected the state to protect their right to do that. Right? The other priority, of course, was relocating spouses, let's skip over that. And reconstructing the family wasn't always based on patriarchal authority. And this is something that again worse than talk about this, but think about, you know, part of the Freedmen's Bureau records show that African American families often were full of dissension, of dissent, because a lot of the women did not accept the assumption of patriarchal authority, in part because patriarchal authority on the plantation system was based on the master, right? Not based on sort of nuclear family within a slave household. The master was the patriarchal. Once you throw the master out, it meant that women had more autonomy. And they acted with more autonomy. And many of the women were involved in what's called, men and women involved in what's called broad marriages, which means they don't live on the same plantation, which is actually quite common. And for that reason, they had more autonomy, more decision-making in terms of raising their children, in terms of working together as a community of women. And so when people won the right to marry and have those marriages protected, and men started to assert patriarchal authority, they got some pushback. For example, women were willing to sign labor contracts under the men's name. Women insisted on demanding the right to be paid wages to themselves, not to the husband. Right? They insisted that they would not be liable for the husband's debt at country stores. And they participated in those political conversations, like the picture I showed you. So that's part of the story. The right to land, real quickly. Obtaining land was the most important thing, along with the goal of literacy, and DuBois talks about this. And it was assumed by many people that they would take the land. You've read probably stories of David's Den, right? That's also in your work. Enslaved people at the end of, in fact, during the Civil War, began to divide up plantations among themselves with the expectation that they would get it. For time's sake, I'm going to skip over all that. You can talk about it. Because actually, you know what? You probably know more about that than I do. And we can go back. I'm really afraid of time here.
We've
heard that term, 40 acres of the Negro.
Yeah.
It comes from somewhere. Right. We know it comes from somewhere. Right. And that when African Americans, black leaders believed that the federal government was responsible for mass redistribution, they weren't wrong, they weren't crazy. Because there was discussion. In fact, their precedents, there's General Sherman's Field Order Number 15, which I think I might have. Well, no, I don't. But you should have read about it, because it comes up again in these chapters, it comes up in, where he just simply began to redistribute land among free people. It just made perfect sense. There's a Navy occupation in Port Royal, which the boys does talk about in this chapter, in South Carolina, and there are other seizures of plantations. But all of these incidents, you raise them up to this like really high level. But those incidents were haphazard. They weren't systematic, nor were they constitutional, okay, which becomes an issue. They could have been constitutional. The military could have taken more land in the Second Confiscation Act in 1862. But instead, the way that land was distributed, it was made available to black settlement through the non-payment of taxes. The land that people could pay taxes on was legally allowed to be distributed or optional, you know, to buyers. I should say something about the question of constitution, because even Abraham Lincoln worried that if he started to redistribute land or confiscate land, that this would be a violation of the Constitution because you're taking private property. Remember, it's a violation of the Amendment. Now, we've already referred to like how hypocritical that is, because there was no violation of taking Native people's land, right? No violation at all, despite the fact that they were actually signed in treaty, number one. Number two, there was no issue about giving land to corrupt capital. Giving land, because they didn't pay for that land, right? They didn't pay for it. And so meanwhile, the little bits of land that's available for redistribution of fee people, for fee people, they end up auctioning that land. And the whole story about Port Royal is such a tragic one, because here's an opportunity to redistribute land. Instead, they auction it off. Who shows up? Speculators. And they buy most of the land. The amazing story, and this goes back to something you had said about the way that DuBois tries to tell the story with such dignity, is that I think it's like 17,000 acres of land, 2,000 of those acres were bought by Black people, by former soldiers and their families. And what did they do? This goes back to the division of the state. They pooled their money together to buy plots of land and either own it collectively or divide up in smaller plots. And the idea of pooling your money together to purchase land, the distribution of that property wasn't based on who put in more money. It was based on the idea of wholeness, that there's no outside, that you bring people inside, and that once you're inside, you take care of each other. Now, were there Black land speculators? Of course there were. Were there people who were just, you know, criminals? Of course there were. But in most of these cases, when they did pull their money together, they spent a lot of money, they were able to redistribute the land among themselves and try to develop new ways of living. So, to go back real quickly, the Freedmen's Bureau was created. You remember, the Freedmen's Bureau was called the Bureau of Refugees, Freedmen, and Abandoned Land. And we should always call it that. If you call it the Freedmen's Bureau, we end up thinking about it just in terms of the management of human labor. But it's called the Bureau of Refugees, Freedmen, and Abandoned Lands. So it was created in 1865 for the authority to divide abandoned and confiscated lands into 40-acre plots for rent and for eventual sale. Let me just repeat that. It had the authority to divide up abandoned and confiscated lands for rent or eventual sale to free people, but not as grants. It was not to be given away. Because again, the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution, it's like property sacrosanct, unless it's Native people property. That's another story. So the Bureau still had this capacity. They could have sold this land. Few people could have bought it, but they only controlled about 0.2% of the land in the South, a very, very tiny amount. And much of that land wasn't even arable, you know, meaning you can grow from it. And they did not have legal power to give title to land. Okay? So whatever possibilities there were, President Johnson, you know, after he became president, he restored his all the land to ex-slave holders, including the land obtained through General Sherman's Field Order Number 15. And by the way, you may remember this, but there were 40,000 Black people that he settled on those lands. They were all thrown off the land, violently dispossessed. And so that's something to consider. You also probably remember reading in the chapter on Mississippi and Louisiana the possible Christmas insurrection of 1867, which is all about the expectation of getting land. So, now, quickly to the point of today, the radical reconstruction. So where we pick up the story is the moment when the Republican-dominated Congress begins to succeed in opposing Johnson's plan. And they overturn it, they impeach him, and of course they don't succeed. They succeeded in impeachment, but it was the same in conviction. but this is when the balance of power shifts. So what the radical Republicans wanted to do was dissolve all those governments that Johnson had put in place, which were basically old plans of running things again, and then pass laws protecting civil rights. In other words, they overturned the black votes by passing the Civil Rights Bill of 1866. And that Civil Rights Bill of 1866 is very important because it defined all persons born in the United States as citizens. Okay? And spelled out the rights they would enjoy. I want to talk about this. You might have talked about it last time, but this is before the 14th Amendment. This precedes the 14th Amendment. So much of the language of the 14th Amendment begins with the Civil Rights Act of 1866. I just want you to have to remember that always. So based on the principle of equality before the law, the bill prohibited states from passing laws that discriminate on the basis of race. So you can't pass laws that discriminate on the basis of race. And that deprived any citizen of the right to make contracts, bring lawsuits, and enjoy equal protection of one person's property. You know, all this is what the black votes actually did. So basically rendered all the black votes illegal. And it's important because even though the 14th Amendment officially overturned Dred Scott and officially granted citizenship, the Civil Rights Bill effectively did that. It began the process. So what did Johnson do? He vetoed the bill, argued that it was a violation of states' rights. We've seen that over and over again. Last, you still see it. And then he argued that African Americans did not deserve the right to citizenship because it would be discriminating against the white race. And remember Johnson said in that chapter on the crisis of disaster that African Americans never asked for the vote, so therefore, you know, they don't really want it. This is when things changed. It's Congress that overrides Johnson's veto and opens the door for the 14th Amendment. I want to talk about the 14th Amendment. And let me just say, I have a little pushback against that film, 13th. A big pushback. We can talk about that. But both the 13th Amendment, which ultimately, whatever limitations, was an abolitionist amendment, you know, and the 14th Amendment, which has radical origins, despite, you know, 14th. Despite that, there's something we've got to consider. So the 14th Amendment, Section 1 being black people's right to be citizens, which of course 1866 Civil Rights Bill laid out and then was ratified in 1868. And it also forbid any state to make any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of another. The part that I want to just pay attention to, and I know that you all know the 14th Amendment backwards and forwards, but I want to share this because it actually has an impact on the question of voting, and that's Section 2. And so much of what Du Bois is talking about in Chapter 9 is about what Section 2 says, which is that, you know, you can beat it, but what it basically says is that any state that disenfranchises black voters, because you know what you can do is punish those states that restrict black voters, or restrict any voters for that matter, excluding people in that sense. But it means that any state that disenfranchises black voters would have its representation reduced accordingly. So if you disenfranchise, so it's like the reversal of the three-fifths clause. And this is something we have to always keep in mind because it has huge implications. So the three-fifths clause is ended at this moment. And now, if you want to have more representation in the South, you got to enfranchise black voters. If you don't, you have less. But in the past, it was the other way around. The disenfranchisement of black voters meant that the South had more political power. This is a way to reduce it. And so the people who wrote this were not necessarily all like friends of the Negro. They also were trying to suppress Southern power, right? And some of those who wrote it were in fact very much believing that enfranchising the black people would not only support the agenda of the Republican Party, but actually people like Danny Stevens and others were like, you know, this is actually going to be good democracy for the first time. Now, finally, a couple things. You got to the Reconstruction Act of 1867-68. And this is the key thing that's happening in the Price of Disaster. That Congress stipulates that in order to pass the 14th Amendment, and DuBois says this, the prerequisite to pass the 14th Amendment, so Congress stipulated the ratification, of the 14th Amendment was a prerequisite for seating elected Southern congressmen. So Southern congressmen cannot be elected unless those states pass the 14th Amendment. And if they did not, the Reconstruction Acts was ratified. The Reconstruction Acts allowed Congress to reimpose military rule over those states. This gets to the question of dictatorship in democracy. When he talks about the dictatorship of the black proletariat in South Carolina or Mississippi or elsewhere, he doesn't quite go that far, but he's talking about dictatorship. And for Du Bois, dictatorship is actually a good thing, a good transitional thing, based on his reading of Marx. And we could debate that, we could talk about that. So 10 states refused to ratify the 14th Amendment. And so therefore they had the provisional governments be placed on military rule under radical Republicans. Congress then required some states to rewrite their constitutions, and this is where we get to this. And the idea was to rewrite these state constitutions that would supersede those passed during presidential rule. In other words, Andrew Johnson, as you know, appointed these people, they wrote these constitutions that were really set up with black votes in mind, embedded in them. So there's new state constitutions, and just like you're saying, this amazing constitutional conventions involving black people, former slaves, many of them helping to write these laws. Now, this is what I think is so amazing. When you look at what they were calling for, and it goes over and over again. These were the most radical social democratic constitutions in the United States. Okay? But they were unconstitutional. This whole process is a violation of the US Constitution. That's why Du Bois keeps saying fetish. Those who fetishize the Constitution. He knows it's illegal. They disenfranchised some white people to do this. Not always. It's a myth to say that they were all, In fact, on the contrary, the percentage of white people disenfranchised under those state constitutions was so minuscule, it didn't really make a difference. Most of the white folks boycotted the ones who wanted to hold the Soviet Union. And they not only boycotted, but they created something which I call dual power. So in other words, Du Bois doesn't quite go this far, but when Du Bois compares the Russian Revolution to Reconstruction, one of the things that actually is very significant is that the Southern former Confederates began to form their own institutions in violent, vigilante, militarized forms of power to basically rule and prepare for the overthrow of Reconstruction, even as the U.S. military is there. So this is a kind of dual power going on. But the difference is that this is dual power that is not only competing, but at odds. At odds. Where in the case of the Russian Revolution, it's a little different. We're going to talk about that if you want to. So I just want to emphasize that these great constitutions were violations of the US Constitution. And yet, I would argue that these are the clearest reflections, or expressions, I should say, of social democracy. If you ever read a book of European history, they will all tell you, social democracy begins in Germany in the 1890s. And I'm saying, that's not true. In fact, I just had a real smart PhD student from Berkeley came down to UCLA and said that. I'm like, sorry, you're wrong. This is where actual social democracy
democracy in a modern republic begins here with these constitutions. Because what they were trying to do wasn't simply
what we think of as negative liberties or negative freedoms.
They were forms of economic empowerment as well as social wage that would make sure that all citizens within that context could receive certain basic things. You know, and what they really wanted to happen and they couldn't, which is stuff like the right to land, in other words. Last thing I'd say, and we'll just have a conversation, is the 15th Amendment, which sort of is the capstone of some of this. And it should be clear that African-American men were voting for the passage and ratification of the 15th Amendment. We know this from 1867. But then the election of Grant in 1868 made things easier for the Republican Party. And in fact, it was black voters who put Ulysses Grant, in office. So in 1868, the South, almost 700,000 black voters voted to sway the election in Grant's favor. If it wasn't those black voters, he would not have won. That's a small thing, but it's a big thing. Meanwhile, opposition to the radical reconstruction spawned the growth of the Democratic Party in the South and the North. The Democratic Party, this is where I have these like images, the Democratic Party was already problematic and racist, but now the whole edifice was built on anti-black racism and on building white solidarity and trying to break what was the interracial alliance of abolition democracy. Therefore, Republican support for the black franchise was also driven by not just moral and ethical reasons, but driven by political considerations since black voters were more loyal to the Republican Party. Black voters were more loyal to the Republican Party. And had it not been for black voters, the Democratic Party would have ruled massively. And this is why the 15th Amendment is so important. Because it gave all males the right to vote, irrespective of color. It ended disfranchisement based on race and left the door open for other means of denying the vote, of course, like voter suppression, property requirements, poll taxes. But as a result, a lot of African American men were elected to positions, and we know about the big ones. We know about 600 state legislatures, 16 Congress, but we don't always talk about the small ones, like mayors, police chiefs, school commissioners, state militia officers. They sat on juries, they became police officers, tax collectors, and in fact, to go back to the criminal justice system, just a small issue. During the highly radical reconstruction, black men were the ones who ran the criminal justice system the most of the towns where, and I mean that they were the jailers. They were, we even had a black district attorney in one case. They were the ones who were running the police. Not everyone, but in certain areas. And those people who were elected, did push for things like equal access to public schools, women's rights, 10-hour workday, prohibitions against family violence, and the integration of restaurants and business. I had a bunch of questions. I'm going to stop there. If we're going to talk about anything we want to talk about, the two things that are just sort of stuck in my mind, which we don't have to talk about if you don't want to. One just has to do with what DuBois talks about as the labor movement and the importance of what DuBois imagined could have happened had deconstruction succeeded, the labor movement had been united around black rights and working class solidarity. And also what happened in South Carolina, why did it fail? There's lots of reasons for that. And then finally, the question of dictatorship versus democracy. And how do we make sense of the fact that democratic possibilities were only made possible through undemocratic means, through military undemocratic means. And we can't escape that, we can't avoid that, because we get too romantic about that moment.
So like, what do you do? So I'm gonna stop there. I said way too much. And I would love to hear from you and just have a conversation. Does that make sense? Okay.
Now, who funded the Confederacy, and was it their motivation to be paid the influence, the policies of the South to be repaid?
So the first question is who funded?
Yeah, who funded the war for the Confederacy?
Well, that's the planning class.
Right.
I mean, the amazing thing about, it's a really good question, because part of what DuBois argues and what I'm trying to reinforce is this idea that much of the wealth before the Civil War was concentrated in the South. Not only that, but much of what we think of as the cultural capital of the United States was also South. The Southern oligarchy was far better educated to reform education. They were the dominant figures in the U.S. military. And just not an accident, that has a lot to do with the fact that the South had consistently more political power than any other region in the United States. So they were running things. The election of Abraham Lincoln scared shit out of everybody, because no one expected that to happen, right? You begin to see different alliances. So at that point, that's when the Confederacy emerges as, in their minds, a legitimate effort not to cause a war, but to say, you know, we're going to take our resources, we're going to take our land, we're going to take our right to own slaves, and we're going to build our own nation separate from you. And so, again, almost all the major generals in the Confederacy were trained at West Point. They were like, they were ahead. And that's why, militarily, the Confederacy could have defeated the Union Army. I mean, it wasn't an easy battle. They had us international support, they could have defeated the Union Army. And so they had resources. The problem is that because it was fought in Southern soil, because there was a certain level of isolation in the South, because of the blocking of the Mississippi River and other things that they needed to connect, it meant that they could expend their resources, and once they expend their resources, and once the international market for cotton kind of almost collapses, they don't have the continuation of capital. So that's part of it. That's only part of it. Okay, that's like the surface level. What's beneath the surface though is that where's all the investment? See, that's the thing. And so because it had so much investment in human beings, the human beings became the collateral for debt. So again, this goes back to the question of who has money and who doesn't. This is not about money. That's why the famous quote by Du Bois, when he's giving a talk to the Roosevelt Fund around the same time as Rocky, he said, you know, Americans don't know anything about money. They're just ignorant. So that's our problem. And he says this to the Roosevelt Fund. And what he's saying is that many things, one of the things he's suggesting is that what appears to be enormous wealth, like any wealthy class, is actually borrowed money, borrowed against future profits. And because there was so much wealth to be gained from cotton production, that they can continue to buy slaves and use slaves to mortgage, you know. And so who was making a lot of that money? The middleman. That is, those who are loaning money and those who are the bondsmen. That's why it goes back to that line about the bondsmen. The folks who really won financially, besides the railroad companies, were those who floated the loan to pay for the war. Because they end up getting back their money and interest, and getting back the principal plus an interest. So that's where the whole debate about, well, how did we deal with the loan work then? Did we change the currency so it's inflationary, and then therefore the debt goes down in terms of real numbers? Do we pay it back? Do we forgive the debt? Do we, you know? And so the issue was, it's the debt. The people who own the debt, they're the source of the story. And they're completely out. Du Bois is one of the few people who say, he's paying attention to them. And everyone who looked at this is paying attention to them. But that's not the story that we always hear, because it's not as romantic as, you know. That's why I say it's an excellent question. It's a question about who paid for it, you know. And I talk too much. Yeah.
Well, Du Bois is very powerful and brilliant about anti-black racism, but white supremacy in the U.S. is also based on conquest of Native American land, and of course, just before the Civil War, conquest of half of Mexico, and driven by the idea of continual military expansion to the idea of manifest destiny. So how would you relate those dimensions to the Black Reconstruction analysis?
That's a really good question, and I invite the people to also jump in on it. There's a part of the story that Du Bois doesn't tell, but he's actually very familiar with. And this may actually complicate it even more, and that is the emancipation of slavery in the so-called five civilized tribes. Because part of the story is that the Cherokee ended up splitting, but many of the so-called five civilized tribes ended up siding with the Confederacy because they owned slaves. And so part of that struggle that's still with us today about who's indigenous, who's not, blood quantum, the question of land, that's a whole different thing that Du Bois purposely, I think, avoided. Partly because, you know, we didn't know enough about it. But I think that in his own respect of trying to understand his own sort of limited way of thinking about race, he thought about it in biracial terms. You know, and so the stories of Christian, so Oklahoma, all that stuff is out. The fact that the Cherokee Nation itself has violent division between those who support the slavery and those who said, you know, we really need to emancipate our slaves. It's part of the story. And that's also why Western expansion is not necessarily a center. The West is present, because it's in the West that we have the expansion of capital, mines, indigenous, that sort of thing. But he's not telling the story of the West, except when he talks about, when he gets to the frontier land, like they can read about that, he will talk more about it. And he will see some things about indigenous business. But, you know, it's not to defend the Bois, but sort of where he is in 1933 and 1935. That's not the conversation that we're having. But it's one that, fortunately, all these other scholars have taken up. The problem is that the issue about slavery in Indian lands, that is an issue that some people just don't want to talk about at all. Because it sort of, again, undermines certain romantic image about who's a victim and who's not. You know? And it's a mistake to think of, as some people have tried to write, that somehow slavery among the Choctaw, the Cherokee, the Cree, that somehow that slavery was like nicer. They were not mean, they didn't have those. On the contrary, it was exactly the same. And that's why they're called civilized tribes. Because they weren't trying to be there. They were trying to be white, in a sense. I mean, so they were trying to, those who owned slaves. But again, just like much of the Confederacy, 75% of the white people in the South did not own slaves. They just didn't. And on top of that, some of the white people who lived in the upper, parts of the Deep South and in the border states joined the Union. And for that, they were meted out some incredibly violent attacks in part of the place. You know, and that's another story. So it's all kind of. Anyone else want to add to that? Yeah.
I just want to throw out a resource. It's a really great book called Ties That Bind by Brian Miles. Yeah. It tells the story of a Cherokee man who ends up marrying a black woman who was formerly his slave, and talking about, and then like he dies, and then there's this question of like who gets the land, and so it's like all of these forces that we're talking about all coming together.
Exactly. That's an excellent book. Time Nash used to be here. And then there's also Barbara Krauthammer, who wrote this other book that's precisely about emancipation in Virginia, which came out. There's all this stuff out there about it. And again, each one of the stories that DuBois tells can definitely be deepened and complicated by what we know now.
I think this book is really interesting, and it's really difficult to read for me. I think the level of detail is just very unfamiliar for history for me. But you know, as I read, it's hard to. I just keep wondering how much this book is still important or still used in this field of study. You know, Paula mentioned there's some inaccuracies, and I'm like, well, what things are, you know, what is not? You have alluded to some of the things that aren't coming through, but are there? I don't know. I guess my question is sort of a broad one, like, how useful does this book feel still?
That is a response, but to pile on. Could you talk about, like, we discussed how it was used as a project, right? Or like what his research meant to be doing it. Could you talk about how it was used then?
Right.
Like now authors go on book tours, right?
Exactly.
And we bring in like-minded folks, so like who is his audience then, and like how was it brought into public, if at all, or was it meant for the racist Harvard professors, or was it like, yeah, in whose hands did it land, and why was that important, or did it only land more recently?
These are two excellent questions, and again, I'm going to say something, because they're both connected, actually.
Yeah,
I also want to invite everyone else to like respond. Especially, you know, I know some of you actually know this expression, but let me just give you my personal opinion on this first question. I think that this is one of the two most important history books written in the 20th century. Period. You know, naturally, it's hard to nitpick because he gets basically right. I mean, it's not the stuff that has been added since then that he doesn't deal with. Like we could talk about gender and women. We have lots of stuff about that we can talk about. He doesn't. No one deals with that then. But in terms of the basic argument he's making, which is, it's a speculative. And it does tie to what's happening in that period. So he's saying that contrary to everything that's been written about Reconstruction, which you're going to read about in the very last chapter, where he talks about like the sort of the historiography. But contrary to everything that's been written, what happened in the South was the first significant, serious experiment in social democracy, we call it abolition democracy, led by formerly enslaved people, poor whites, because the white working classes, they're not victims, they're agents in this story. And when he talks about the constitutional conventions, like just the chapters that we read in the city, he's saying, look, there's people like Cardozo, who, by the way, is like is a grandfather or a great-grandfather, as long as they're is a relationship there. But it's not a good voice for us. But that people like Cardozo and others are part of a black elite who are
saying, no, you can't confiscate property. No, you can't pass laws that would allow poor people to get out of labor contracts. They're there actually protecting the community. So DuBois is critiquing his class. And he's struggling because this is his class, these are his people. So he's like discovering that, wait a second, my class doesn't always make the best choices. You know, and sometimes they're misleaders. And he's saying, he's recognizing for the first time in his natural born life, wait a second, all these masses of people who are unnamed have showed up and come up with a vision of democracy that not only could have transformed the South, but would have rolled back the power of Northern capital. So he said, the power, the capital would have not been able to succeed if they could have succeeded with the vision of the state and democracy that they laid out. Number one. Number two, and if that happened, if Northern capital had been brought down to its knees, the potentialities for something like socialism were there. But more than that, that's not even, that's the most speculative part is saying, if they won that battle, you not only would not have had Jim Crow, lynching would have been the thing that followed, but you would have stopped imperialism in its tracks. That imperialism would not have to take, you could have stopped it. Because he's saying, look, what follows the end of Reconstruction? The Berlin Conference, 1884, 85. Now, you could say, well, the United States wasn't, of course the United States was around the table. They were involved. But it's not just about the United States. It was about the fact that imperialism in Africa and the rest of the islands of the sea, as he puts it, in Asia, was about the movement, the flow of capital, about what to do with surplus. And so, with the U.S. as its industrial force, the part of the U.S. economy depend on European industry. Was tied together. So he's saying that this is what could have happened. Now we could be wrong. I mean, we don't know the speculation. But he has figured out the kernel of the problem. So now, there's one other layer. And this goes back to your question. Why does he write it in 1933-34? What's America, what's the world involved in by 1933-34? And he says, this is, I think I have a quote from Cedric Robinson. If I could find it, I may find it. But he says, if Reconstruction had succeeded, if it had been defeated, it didn't fail on its own, right? It was violently destroyed. If it had succeeded, that we may not have had World War I. Mm-hmm. And if we didn't have World War I, we damn for sure wouldn't have World War II. That fascism wouldn't have emerged. We could have stopped fascism then. You know? This is what he's saying. And we all know, we all of you know this, where does fascism begin? It begins in colonialism. That's the beginnings of it. Right? So that's what makes the book so important, that argument. And that's why he wrote it in 1935, because 33, 34, 35. So what he decided is he's trying to figure out, well, he says, clearly my idea of the talented 10 is not working. Clearly there's a revolution taking place. I'm going to find this book, because it's actually worth thinking about in Cedric Robinson's book. I was just looking at it saying, oh my God, yeah, that's right. And it's from a quote, it's from a speech. Let's see that he gives. Okay, here we go. So he gives a speech at the Rosenwald Fund. And he says, okay, it's worth just sharing this. He says, again, he's sort of writing Black Reconstruction at the same time, and he says, the matter of greatest importance, he's talking to Rosenwald, the matter of greatest importance is that instead of our facing today a stable world moving at a uniform rate of progress
toward well-defined goal. We are facing revolution. I trust you will not be scared by this wordless word as you were Thursday's conference on heroes. And he says, I'm not discussing a coming revolution. I'm trying to impress the fact upon you that you are already in the midst of a revolution. This is 1935. You're already in the midst of war. And there has been no war of modern times that has taken so great a sacrifice of human life and human spirit as the extraordinary period through which we are passing today. Some people envisage revolution chiefly as a matter of blood and guns and the more visible methods of force. But that, after all, is merely temporary outward manifestation. Real revolution is within. That comes before or after the explosion. Is a matter of long suffering and deprivation, the death of courage, and the bitter triumph of despair. This is the inevitable prelude to decisive and enormous change. And that is the thing that is now on us. And that's what he's saying. That is what's happening in the 1860s and 70s. He goes, we are not called upon then to discuss whether or not we want revolution or not. We have got it. Our problem is how we're going to come out of it. Right? And so he's saying that we're in a revolution, and unless we learn from what he calls a black, what God has called a black revolution, he said, unless we learn from these ordinary people, these former slaves, about what it means to make real social democracy, we're going to be doomed. He's saying we have lessons to learn from Reconstruction about how to respond to fascism. That's why he wrote. And that's why he went to study Marx. And part of that was also his critique of the Communist Party, because he felt that the Communist Party failed miserably to actually recognize the vision and power of black working people, and that tending to the needs and struggles of black working people in this particular instance would then open up the prospects for real democracy, which the United States would have. You know, and if you don't have real democracy, we're going to go in the way of fascism. And that's part of it. That's the context. No, that makes sense.
Could we talk about dictatorship? I'm surprised at how much Du Bois talks about the need for dictatorship, like the proletariat.
Well, before I talk about that, so you all read about dictatorship. What did you think about what he says? You can even go back to passages in the book. I'm gonna read it and find out what you think. There's a passage in particular that struck me as really important. I think it's page B45. So B45. Okay, so I'm just going to read certain parts of it, and then I want to get your reaction. So he says, toward a third down, there was a dictatorship backed by the military arm of the United States by which the government of the southern states were to be coerced into accepting a new form of administration in which the freedmen and the poor whites were to hold the overwhelming balance of political power. And then, as soon as political power was successfully delivered into the hands of those elements, the federal government was to withdraw and full democracy ensued. That was the theory. He says, the difficulty with this theory was the failure to realize that such dictatorship must last long enough, really, to put the mass of workers in power. That this would be, in fact, a dictatorship of the proletariat, which must endure until the proletariat, or at least a leading united group with clear objects and effective method, had education and experience and had taken firm control of the economic organization of the South. Right? And then finally he says at the bottom, it was inconceivable, therefore, that the masters of Northern industry, through their growing control of the American government, were going to allow the laborers of the South for any more real control, industry, than was necessary to curb the political power of the planters and their successors. I need my glasses. But, so, what do you think about that? Right? The three things. You gotta have dictatorship. The dictatorship has to be of the working people, the people who actually are without power, the people who were once working.
right? The people who are poor, they have to run things, they have to run things longer with military support to protect them in order to create the conditions for democracy. Yo, so I'm not going to talk.
I think some of the response to the word dictatorship of the proletariat, for me, I'm very comfortable with it because I don't understand it in terms of terror, one person having control, causing all kinds of like violence, right? I don't associate it, that word dictatorship of the proletariat in that phrase in that sort of way. I associate it as a way in terms of the proletariat being able to embrace its power and be able to develop the capacity to create a society in which the proletariat has freedom and provides these kinds of things. So I don't have that same kind of, I don't have an adverse reaction to the word dictatorship in that way.
Anyone else?
I really liked the parts in these chapters where DuBois was talking about how just foolish it seems to rely on a document 90 years old or whatever he was talking about at the time, like the Constitution, however old it was at that point, to determine how to proceed in a new era. Mm-hmm. And I felt like what he was writing was this sort of critique of originalism, which we are still dealing with now as a conservative movement. And you know, I don't know what you were saying earlier about the way in which Du Bois is conscious of the fact that some of this movement is not constitutional. Some of these actions to secure an abolition of democracy or a dictatorship of the proletariat have to come by other means. I don't know, I think it's very interesting, it's very provocative. It speaks to this moment, I think, in terms of thinking about anti-fascist movement and this whole question of free speech, you know, how much speech should certain elements be allowed, and how do you begin to quash that which seeks to constrict others' freedom if our ultimate goal is to respect everyone's freedom. You know, this question of should the planters have the vote? You know, of course not. That's crazy. But yeah, what we saw happened.
Right.
I don't know, it's kind of like,
keep in mind that there were black leaders who were pushing for the vote to make sure they can have vote. Now, just to be clear, you all know where the term dictatorship and culture comes from, right? From Marx.
Yeah.
So what Marx and Engels, and they talk about in the Communist Manifesto, and they talk about it elsewhere, what Marx was referring to was, it's a recognition that there already, even in a bourgeois democracy, there was already a dictatorship of property. So keep in mind, this is the 19th century, and this is also a document, the Communist Manifesto is a document that's sort of written in 1848. And the 1848 revolutions in Europe also spawned part of that migration of some German radicals who come to the United States into being abolitionists. Not all of them, but a lot. Actually, really, quite a few. And so when he says dictatorship of the proletariat, he meant basically replacing property, which is the dictatorship of the working class, with the working class, right, making the decisions rather than properly making decisions for them. And it's not anti-democratic. And this is important because it's not that Marx, when he wrote that, or Engels, when he wrote that, that they were saying, oh, we want to get rid of the vote, or we want to disenfranchise. We want to seize power from those who have power over us. That is property, capital. And he's saying it's a transitional period before you can have something like socialism, which is the abolition of private property. You know, under a state form. In communism, which is ultimately the disappearance of the state, you don't need a state anymore if the culture has changed so much. And so the fact, so what Du Bois is referring to is he's really Marx feverishly. He's at that university reading Marx as his pathway, and as that wonderful slide that you put up before, trying to figure out, okay, how do I write about Reconstruction? And so dictatorship of the proletariat basically meant that it was a lot. He said they never achieved it. But the idea was that the poor, the dispossessed, black, white, would be able to, for the first time, take that property, redistribute it, take the reins of government, which had been used against the poor who had been disadvantaged. I remember most white poor people had not voted. Eliminate property plans, eliminate power property, and then create a democracy that's based on rule of people as opposed to property. And if the proletariat is the majority of the people, then they would be the ones who rule. So it's tricky because then we have to kind of, and I really want to know what you think about it. You have to deal with the question of, does it require military force?
Yes.
Well,
so that's the thing. So one of the things I wanted to bring up was that, you know, the chapter that you cited, you said that, you know, the military wasn't there long enough for the social the Reconstruction was to get legislated or culturally implemented and embodied. But black folks didn't take over a government. And there was no way that they would ever have been able to establish that without taking that control. They were in the military, but they weren't leading the military charge. And if they had, then the possibilities of that actual liberation happened. And so, the experiment of social democracy doesn't work because with former slaves and black workers didn't take control.
Well, can I?
No, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I wanted to propose something, a different reading of that, where I feel like Du Bois, and I don't care what anybody else thinks, I feel like he's saying in some ways they did take charge of the military, not numerically, but almost, trying to think of a, for lack of a better term, spiritually. They interjected a certain spirit that by their participation, particularly when they took up arms, that they changed a civil war into a revolution. I feel like Du Bois keeps coming back, and it's not to argue against what you're saying, Jay, but to, like, is that he's saying they transformed the war itself, even if all the elements of the war making were still, had their original origin or whatever, and that they're still in control by the North, by the, you know, but that their activity within the war changed the war quite qualitatively. And so I don't know, I just wanted to throw that in there and that idea around leadership and how thinking about that in Du Bois' time around, because he specifically talks about the Russian Revolution. You think about the idea of a vanguard party, that's not the case in the Civil War. But then thinking about how Du Bois is reconciling that and how these institutions or even these wars of oppression can be transformed. I don't know, so that was one thing that's on my mind.
I would add one aspect, a really important point. And I would add one other thing that Du Bois doesn't talk about, both in there, but so much detail you're gonna miss it. That there's two levels of military power. One level is the Union Army, but there's another level, and that is the black militias. And there's some numbers that are not in that book, but according to Robert Smalls, between 1868 or 1866, and I think around 1880 something, so 20-year period, 53,000 black people were murdered, were killed in war. So when we think of the Civil War, it doesn't end. And Du Bois actually said this, when he talks specifically about Louisiana, he has a lot of Louisiana, the war continued, the war never ended. And so what happened was, black people actually armed themselves, and armed self-defense and the right of the state to protect them was one of the demands. So with armed self-defense, they, those meetings, the picture I showed you, what you can't see are the armed sentries that are around them. The fact that the Klan was not just some mean, rich white people's organization, their response to armed black people. And so what did the Klan do? What were the black folks? The black folks were also first disarming or denying some black people the right to bear arms. But also even after the black folks in the 1870s, we have like the force acts and all these other things that on the one hand is supposed to suppress the Klan, but the Klan was also taking black people's guns. And so there's so the question of whether or not they could hold the state does have something to do with the inability to sustain the military power. On the other hand, this goes back to the point that Isaac's making, which is the key thing. This was a revolution, and that's why he shows that each of these state cases, you can read about in Alabama, he's saying that these were successes that were undermined. And they were undermined by graft, by corruption, and most of those people engaged in graft and corruption and mismanagement, and the Klan.
Yeah, by terror.
By terror. But a lot of people were not necessarily black people. But that's not the story you get. The story you get is that there was so much graft and corruption by black people who were incompetent that the Klan had to save the day. Mm-hmm. But it's a flip side. He's saying it was a success. We're talking about what it meant for the success of the short-lived successes of democracy. I mean, it's exactly the story. And that's what he's trying to prove. He's saying, tell the benefits of Reconstruction. He's saying, no, they were actually doing pretty well. And that's why I keep saying that this wasn't a failure, this wasn't a failure, this wasn't a failure. But then, as you get down to here, when you read the Counter-Revolution of Property, that's going to lay out the case to show that Reconstruction did not fail, it was destroyed.
That's right.
And go back to the Russian Revolution, imagine what would happen had the Bolsheviks lost the Civil War. And that's part of what Du Bois is thinking about. The Bolsheviks in some ways defeated the white armies in the Civil War. And that in some ways is the good news. The bad news is that in so doing so, they created a military state and never left it. Mm-hmm. They never left it, which undermined the potential for democracy there. So of course, with that, and this is a question I have for you, what if they had succeeded through military means, how long would it have taken? Mm-hmm. Or would they end up with a version of the Russian state? You had to.
We have like 5 minutes. No, it's fine. We could push it to the limit. I do want to debrief real quick, but let's just keep going. No.
Yeah, I think this is related to the same question. What I have a hard time is deriving from Du Bois' description of the social, the by Reconstruction social democracy, what sort of economy it envisioned. To me, that there doesn't seem to be, it seems to be heavily agricultural. And it implies all sorts of things about the capacity of such an organization that didn't happen. But is that developed somewhat later in the book and haven't kind of gotten there yet? What sort of economy is envisioned by the social democracy that was envisioned by freedom?
Right. Well, even in these chapters, the one thing that he does show is that
he has this line, I don't know what page it's on, where he says, much of the leadership had no clear conception or radical conception of economy.
How it would work.
Right. So for a lot of them, they actually believed in property, property rights, and believed in capitalism. And that's like the whole section about the labor movement is about what he feels like is the failure of the labor movement to be truly radical and actually follow what ordinary people actually wanted.
I mean, it looks like it's running towards a small landed proprietor economy, which we've been competitive in the world.
Exactly. And he doesn't answer the question.
Yeah, but he doesn't take on the question. Right. That's what I asked for.
Right.
Nobody's ever answered that.
Yeah. But he's right. He doesn't take on the question, but he does suggest that, that's why the book's so big.
Yeah.
He does see a failure of vision on the part of Black leadership. As well, but he's not willing to say, you know, they could have been socialists.
Yeah.
And I understand that, but that is the question we're left with.
Well, I was just thinking about the concept of the dictatorship of the proletariat in conjunction with the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment. The 13th Amendment. Barring the punitive clause, equal protection clause of the 14th, and suffrage of the 15th. I mean, they're really beautiful amendments. And didn't they just mitigate the need for a military imposition of this dictatorship? I mean, in theory. I mean, I think for some framers of those amendments, that was their ideal.
Right.
That we are creating this equal and just society through the Constitution, not through military means.
Right, but see, it's enforcement.
Well, yes, that's the main
problem.
We're still working still.
No, and I think, I mean, I'm not disagreeing, of course, clearly, especially with the 13th Amendment and convict leasing and vagrancy laws, etc. at the time. But from an ideal perspective, I mean, they are wonderful amendments, right?
Except, you know, I was too quick to say that about enforcement. That's the obvious thing. The thing that's not so obvious is that these were flawed amendments as well, the 14th and 15th in particular, because the 14th Amendment was based on certain principles in the Fifth Amendment about private property. And so it's equality under the law, but equality under the law allows the 14th and 14th Amendment to defend capital. So the Supreme Court in 1880 is all about using the 14th Amendment saying equal protection means that, you know, capital should be protected and defended. And so there's that. And the 15th Amendment had these little slippages, like saying, well, we can make some exceptions for property as means of franchise, exceptions for literacy. So the fact that was holding out there like as a threat, it enabled disfranchisement in 1890. So when the state constitution would be written in the 1890s, the age of the beginning of the former Jim Crow, and then they're not violations of the 15th Amendment. They should have been, but when they wrote it, the people who wrote it were not that radical.
Not that. Sorry.
Radical. In other words, they didn't want to go all the way. Mm-hmm. To go all the way would be a 15th Amendment that said that there's no absolute ability to justify the denial of the right to vote. That there's nothing, but only age, in this case gender, but only age. But that's not what they did. Because in the end, who are the Republicans? The radical, the same radical Republicans are also the radical supporters of capital and industry. And so DuBois' whole thing is that if you had actually allowed poor black and white people, labor movement had been strong enough to allow poor black and white people to be the ones who run things, then capital couldn't have won. But instead, the black Republicans were the ones who became the chosen horse for capital. So,
So I want to just talk about the military, because I mean, I believe in a dictatorship of the proletariat, but I don't think that the military ever was, I mean, the revolution did not extend into the time of Reconstruction. I mean, they were disenfranchising or taking up, what do they call it, barring a lot of Black people from being in the military. I mean, and they never really came up against the planters. I mean, there was no real opposition to the reign of terror that the white supremacists were having as a parallel force. And that was never really challenged sufficiently militarily for Reconstruction to be able to go forward.
Yes. All I would say is that in the places where it was challenged, specifically the hearings on the Klan, for example, it proved that the military can be a deterrent. But the most important thing is that the places where it really was challenged is by Black militias. Mm-hmm. And see, the Black militias, the Black
right, but that's, yeah.
Yeah, but see, that's parallel to Black militias, that was the issue. That was the real failure, because it's true, the Union Army, except for some exceptions, it did protect. I mean, there's some things that were very detailed and made a huge difference. But the withdrawal was a slow process. And in the end, once you outlawed the Black militias and once you took away people's rights and their arms, then that left people really vulnerable. And that's why we're talking about 53,000. Period of 20 years. But still, we're still left with this question. I know our time's up, but as you read, I really want, you know, as you discuss this, I really want you to think really hard about the counterfactual. Like, what would have happened if you had a true dictatorship of proletariat and the military was there occupying the South until 1925? And there's no way the Black militias alone could have been powerful enough to beat back, but if they really suppressed the Klan and the Whites, the Knights of Liberia and all the terrorist organizations successfully, and just gave the military dictatorship until somehow, you know, because we still have the problem that we haven't talked about, which is called American blind spot. Because in the end, when I teach this in my class at UCLA, I end with a slide of Wilmington in 1898. Because the story of Reconstruction goes way beyond this. The possibilities of interracial political organizing among labor actually don't slow down after 1877, they accelerate. The period after 1877 is far more radical than this period. We don't know that though. And Du Bois is like, I'm not dealing with that. He does say in chapter 9, he does say, you know, I'm not dealing with it, but remember that later white workers come to realization with the populist movement that they made a mistake. Right? But not all of them did that. Many of them actually sided again with white supremacy. So Wilmington, North Carolina of 1898 was a coup d'etat where Black elected officials and a fusion party of populists and Republicans and others actually held power. They were defeated by Democrats in every part of the state, including the governorship, except for Wilmington. So what do white people do? They took guns and they just basically opened to the government. Like, not like pretend to. They literally were killing people and they opened to the government and they replaced the government through force of arms. And they had to do that. And so, again, it's a really hard thing to think that we could, the reason they were able to do that, because a lot of white people who probably should have continued to support abolition democracy decided, you know what, we're going with the coup. And you had parties emerge called the white man's parties and this kind of thing. So could it really have happened? In other words, would all that racism be unlearned under a military dictatorship in 25, 30, 40, 50 years, 100 years? That's a question. I don't know the answer. That's the question you all can figure out.
On that note, let's thank all the panelists.